Hi, I'm Kathy Smith, the director of the Center for Law and Society here at Community College of Philadelphia. Today, the Center for Law and Society Perspective Series focuses on bankruptcy in a conversation with Ann Belknap. Ann Belknap is an attorney who is a partner in her own firm in Bucks County, Pennsylvania. She's been practicing law for 19 years. She's received the Legal Services of New Jersey Equal Justice Medal for outstanding pro bono work and has done extensive lectures in the area of bankruptcy. She's also an adjunct professor in the ABA-approved Paralegal Studies program here at Community College of Philadelphia. Welcome, Ann. Let's start out by talking about the purpose of bankruptcy. Why do we have bankruptcy laws? Why don't we just let folks collect the money that they're owed?
Well, a lot of times people don't have the money to pay the debts that they owe. So by having bankruptcy, it allows for an orderly liquidation of assets and an orderly payment to creditors, depending on how they rank under the bankruptcy code. So it really is to promote fairness, both for the debtors who need the relief that a bankruptcy can offer, and also for creditors who are trying to collect the most that they're entitled to receive.
I remember hearing about throwing folks in debtors' prisons. Did that really happen?
Absolutely, people were thrown into prison. You'll remember Robert Morris, who was a signer of the Declaration of Independence. He ultimately ended up in debtor's prison, and people were imprisoned for owing debts until 1898. In 1898, we enacted a bankruptcy law that remained in effect really through 1979, when it underwent massive overhauls. But we've been working more or less off of that original bankruptcy law since 1898, and that has outlawed debtors' prisons. Now, there are times that certain debtors will find themselves in prison. Two great examples are if you have an outstanding domestic support obligation where a debtor is obligated to pay child support or alimony and he or she fails to do that, or in instances where an individual owes the IRS money. There are times, especially if there are fraud and evasion, tax evasion elements to the failure to pay those types of debts, an individual may wind up in prison.
Do they stay in prison till they pay their debt off? How does that work? Do they serve a sentence?
Generally speaking, if you are in jail for, again, owing the IRS money, there is usually some criminal element underlying that, so you will be in prison until your sentence is served. For the debtor who owes a domestic support obligation, oftentimes the goal is really not to keep you in prison, it's to force you to pay the money. So once you come up with so much money, then the judge will let you out of jail.
So if we owe credit card debt, we don't have to worry about going to prison for that?
Generally not, and that is a question that clients ask me all the time. They're very afraid, and a lot of times the debt collectors who are calling and harassing these clients and debtors do indicate that they can be imprisoned for failure to pay these types of debts, the Visa debts, the MasterCard debts. But that is a fallacy. That is not going to happen. Prisons are overcrowded, and we just don't have the room, and taxpayers really don't want the burden of having these types of individuals in prison.
That brings us to the typical reasons folks go into bankruptcy. You hear a lot about the woman who goes off and buys 5 fur coats, or the guy who travels around the world and then they go in merrily declaring bankruptcy. Is that really the most common kind of reasons for going into bankruptcy?
That really is not the common reason, although once many years ago I did have the woman who bought the fur coat the day before she filed. Obviously she ended up paying for that fur coat. But the reason people are calling and wanting to declare bankruptcy is because they have debts that they can't handle, whether they're the MasterCards and the Visas that they can't handle, whether they have medical bills. With the economy the way it is right now, people are losing their jobs, they can't afford the COBRA benefits, so you're seeing more and more people without medical insurance. It doesn't take a whole lot of illness to rack up some significant medical debt. That is a huge reason people are filing bankruptcy. You also see mortgage foreclosures, which are at an all-time high. In fact, there are 4.6 foreclosures every minute in the United States. A lot of this goes back to these crazy mortgages, the adjustable rate mortgages, and people are unable to pay the mortgages when the rates adjust. You also now have a very high rate of unemployment, which again impacts the ability of debtors to be able to pay their bills as they come due. So those are the main reasons that people do seek relief under the bankruptcy code.
What are they like emotionally? How does that impact them? You know, what does it feel like for them when you see them?
Well, most people liken it to going to the dentist. It is not a place they want to be. They find it to be very unpleasant. Oftentimes they're humiliated. It is not uncommon for grown men to sit in my office and weep with embarrassment and shame. Generally, when people come to see me, it is the last step. People are feeling very desperate. They don't have any place to turn. Sometimes they're looking at trying to keep their family with a roof over their head. So it's really very emotional. A lot of times I feel much more like a counselor than I do an attorney. But you do occasionally have somebody who is just generally irresponsible, the fur coat lady, who look at these laws as really their way to financially plan. But Congress has done a lot to curb that and has made it tougher and harder for individuals to file bankruptcy and has also lengthened the period of time between bankruptcy filings and discharge that people can file repetitive bankruptcies. So Congress is aware that that was a problem. I don't see it so much anymore, but Congress did address that.
You mentioned how the time period between when you can file bankruptcy has gotten longer. I understand that the bankruptcy code's changed in recent years. What other kinds of changes have there been?
Well, the bankruptcy code underwent a substantial change in 2005. In fact, we now operate under what is known as the Bankruptcy Abuse and Prevention and Consumer Protection Act. And that lengthened the period of time. If you wanted to, say, file a Chapter 7 and get a Chapter 7 discharge, you cannot file another Chapter 7 for 8 years from your prior case. If you had been in a Chapter 7 and received a discharge and you were now looking at filing a Chapter 13, in order to get a discharge in a Chapter 13 bankruptcy, you're looking at a 4-year wait period. Previously, we would do for clients what we called a Chapter 21. Oftentimes, it was necessary to get rid of some of their debt to make them eligible to file a Chapter 13. So we would start out, put them in a Chapter 7, get rid of that debt, which we could discharge in a Chapter 7, which would bring their debt amount below the eligibility limits for a 13, and then we would put them in a 13. Often you would see that in cases where people owed the IRS money, which often are very large debts, but some of that we could get rid of in a 7, make them eligible to file a 13. Chapter 21, as we called it, is now eliminated under the Bankruptcy Abuse Prevention and Consumer Protection Act.
You mentioned a lot of numerals and all that. What can you tell us a little bit about the different chapters? Chapter 7, what's that about? You know, how does that begin?
A Chapter 7 bankruptcy is available to individuals and to corporations. It is a liquidation of unprotected assets. And then
go back a minute. What does liquidation mean?
Okay, liquidation means you're selling off.
The trustee would come in and sell off the assets of the debtor that the debtor is not able to protect either under federal bankruptcy law or under state law. The bankruptcy code does not require somebody to lose all of their assets. For example, if it is a joint husband and wife filing a Chapter 7 and you own real estate that is your principal residence, a debtor and his wife can have $40,400 of equity in their home. They can each have a car that has $3,225 of equity. Again, there are allowances for household goods and furnishings, for wearing apparel, IRAs, 401ks.
When you're saying unprotected, what does that mean? Does that mean that those are the things that you can keep away from the bankruptcy selling off procedure?
That is correct.
And then what happens?
And then if it's a case where the creditors, there's going to be a distribution to creditors, then those creditors will file claims. So sometimes a creditor is a priority creditor, like tax debt or a domestic support obligation is often a priority debt. Secured debt is debt where there's collateral. It could be a mortgage, it could be a car loan, but something where you've given security. And then you have your general unsecured creditors, your credit cards, your medical bills. So again, the bankruptcy prioritizes those types of creditors, and they're paid in the order of priority. So that's a Chapter 7. The majority of consumer cases, individual cases in a Chapter 7, there is no distribution to unsecured or to any creditor, because as attorneys, our goal, people don't want to lose their property. So our goal is to try to protect their property. If there is property that's exposed, then oftentimes we would recommend that they file a Chapter 13 where they're given an opportunity to buy back that equity. So again, if the house has $50,000 of equity in a joint Chapter 13 case, then, you know, roughly $9,600, they would have to buy that back over a period of time, and that would create the pool from which dividends are paid to the creditors.
So in Chapter 7, what's going on is you're selling off the assets that you have, and then they're getting distributed to the creditors. And there's certain things that you can keep. That's pretty much how it works. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. They will get a discharge. They may not be debt-free. Again, if you're paying on a mortgage and you're keeping that home, you obviously have to continue to pay your home. Sometimes people think if they go through a bankruptcy, they get to keep their house free and clear at the end of the bankruptcy. Well, clearly that is not the case. If you want to keep your home or your car and there are liens on that, then you have to continue to pay for those items. But the goal of any bankruptcy is a discharge order, which is the order of the court that legally relieves somebody from an obligation to pay a debt.
Let's turn to Chapter 13. What is Chapter 13 all about? How does that work in comparison to the other chapter?
A Chapter 13 is a repayment plan, and that is available only to individuals who have a regular source of income. So you have to either have a job, or you can use Social Security, or contributions from family that are regular and can be ascertained and verified. But so long as you have some source of regular income, rental income, then you can propose a plan.
Could it be income from Social Security or from public benefits?
It could be, yes.
Okay.
Yes, and then you propose a plan. And again, you have to look at the plan is funded for a period of anywhere from 36 months to 60 months, and a lot of that is dependent upon whether a debtor is above or below median income for the region in which they live. And the median income is tied to the Census Bureau figures, so that's updated on an annual basis.
So what would that be around in this area, the Delaware Valley?
Well, right now, for a household of one, it's a little over $43,000. For a household of five, it's a little over $82,000. So again, you have to look at household size and tie that into the formula.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So they put together this payment plan, and they're agreeing to pay back part of what they owe on different debt. Like, how would it work if I had, you know, credit cards and my mortgage and, you know, so what would it look like?
Okay. Generally in a Chapter 13, individuals are filing a Chapter 13 either because they have assets that they cannot protect under the bankruptcy law or under Pennsylvania state law, or more commonly because they have mortgage arrears or they have arrears owing on a car loan or perhaps IRS debt, something that they need to repay. They want to stop collection activity, so they will file a Chapter 13. And the attorney representing the debtors would propose a plan. So if it was a plan to cure mortgage arrears, you would know more or less, have an estimate at least when you're preparing the plan, how much the arrears are. Ultimately, that creditor would file a claim setting forth the arrears so you could adjust your plan. But your plan would be geared to cure those mortgage arrears over a 36 to 60 month period. If there's an instance where because the debtor has disposable monthly income, which is a new concept, again, came into play with the 2005 bankruptcy amendments. There are instances where, on top of maybe curing a default on a mortgage or a car loan, that you would have to add a certain amount of money to that. We call that the disposable monthly income factor, and that money then is distributed to unsecured creditors on a pro rata basis. So you've heard of bankruptcies where a creditor may receive pennies on the dollar. It's those unsecured general creditors who are going to get the pennies on the dollar, but your secured mortgage arrears or your secured car loan arrears, they would ultimately be paid in full, so that at the end of the day, when you're finished with your case and you're getting your discharge order, you would be current on your mortgage, on your car loan. If you've paid the IRS debt off, you'd be current on that. And your other debt, the unsecured general debt, the credit card debt, the medical bills, whatever else there was, is discharged. So that's how the Chapter 13 works.
So the person isn't paying the debt themselves. They pay it to a trustee, and then the trustee distributes the money to the different creditors?
Yes, there is a Chapter 13 trustee who is appointed when your case is filed, and in fact the debtor makes his or her payment directly to the Chapter 13 trustee every month. So
they pay the trustee, and then the trustee distributes the money, so you're not paying the money directly to your creditors anymore?
Correct.
Okay.
You propose a plan, the court confirms the plan, meaning that it approves the plan. It creates a contract, basically, between the debtor and the creditors, and the trustee is in charge with monitoring that to make sure that it meets the requirements of the law and distributing the funds in accordance with the plan.
Now, suppose I'm going through my 13, everything's going fine, and I lose my job and I can't keep up my payments. What happens then?
Well, that's always difficult. There are times that you can ask the court for an abatement, which means that you're given a short period of time where you're not really forgiven, but there's a period of time, maybe a couple of months, where you're not required to make your payment, but that amount that you have skipped is added on to the back of your plan. So there's not a whole lot of forgiveness in the event of a job loss or some unforeseen circumstances. There are instances where if income declines, but there's still a regular source of income, that you can go ask the court to modify your plan even after it's confirmed based upon the change of circumstances. So that is a possibility. The goal of any bankruptcy is to obtain a discharge, and courts are sensitive to the fact that during a 5-year period, a lot can happen. So that debt that has to be paid, the mortgage arrears, the car arrears, you're either going to have to pay that or you're going to have to surrender that asset. What can happen, however, is that the distribution to unsecured creditors is subject to modification.
Interesting. Let's look at something a little bit different. We see companies advertising that they'll help you with debt relief. Are there alternatives to bankruptcy?
There are. And in fact, as I mentioned earlier, bankruptcy should be the last resort, not the first resort. There are debt relief agencies out there, but it is one of those instances, buyer beware. They're coming out of the woodwork now. They are dealing with people who are very vulnerable, and I often find that clients are watching TV late at night, and they see the little blurb go across the screen, and they're calling, the 1-800 number, and the deal is send us a couple of $1,000 and we'll get your file set up and we'll try to work out a deal with your creditors. And the next thing you know, the client has mailed in $5,000 and they're being served with a civil lawsuit by one of the creditors. And we're seeing that more and more and more frequently. So my word of caution is, if you are going to use a debt relief agency, you have to make sure that the debt relief agency that you choose is a reputable one. A lot of times here in the Delaware Valley, we have Consumer Credit Counseling of Delaware Valley is one example. They are a nonprofit agency. I think you go in and pay them a small administrative fee, a setup fee, and they will try to work with your creditors to get a reduced monthly payment on your debt, to lower the interest rate, and it's not going to cost the individual who's seeking this type of relief a lot of money. If you find you're being asked to pay a lot of money up front, run.
Interesting. And if you do go that route, you can always do bankruptcy later, right?
And oftentimes I do see that. People who have tried to do the debt relief agency and have tried to be in a program to address their debt, oftentimes the monthly payment is still several hundred dollars. And there are times that they will try it for a few months and realize that they still just can't make it and, you know, maintain their lifestyle, albeit an altered lifestyle, but food on the table and pay the medical bills and the utility bills. And that's when they come in and they say, we really feel like we have tried everything in our power to address our financial issues. We don't believe that we have any recourse but to file a bankruptcy.
Since homes are so important, let's go back to that. Let's say that there's a couple that's having trouble paying their mortgage. When does bankruptcy start to make sense as an option? What factors would come into play with deciding that bankruptcy, you know, was the way to go?
Well, the inability to pay a mortgage is always a difficult one. In fact, in the news lately, we have, in fact, the House was supposed to rule or have hearings yesterday on a House bill that would allow judicial modifications due to strong Republican opposition and more Democratic opposition. That's now been pushed off for at least a week. The National Association of Consumer Bankruptcy Attorneys has been a strong advocate of judicial modification of mortgage loans for at least the last 18 months.
When you say judicial modification, that means the judge would be able to change the terms of the mortgage contract?
Yes. What we have proposed is the ability to permit a bankruptcy judge to change the interest rate, the payment, the length of payment, maybe taking a 30-year mortgage to a 40-year mortgage, and also to adjust the amount of the loan, because right now the real estate market has taken such a hit that oftentimes you're seeing people who have paid $350,000 for a home that today they couldn't sell for $290,000. So it would allow them to adjust the loan to the current value of the house. And we strongly support that. It's kind of funny. Bankruptcy judges have been modifying loans forever. They can do a vacation home, they can do a boat, they can do cars, so long as the car loan is more than 910 days old. But the principal residence of an individual so far is a carve-out that bankruptcy judges are not allowed to modify.
So what you're saying is the bankruptcy judge cannot change the terms of a mortgage loan for a primary home?
That is correct. That is absolutely what I mean. And it was, I don't know if it was an oversight or whether it was the financial institutions who have long fought this type of modification, but as of today, bankruptcy judges are not permitted to modify the mortgage on a debtor's personal residence.
Interesting. It sounds like there might be some changes to that.
We are hoping, and President Obama seems to support this, so we're very hopeful, although every time it gets pushed off a week or 2 weeks, it's devastating because, as I said, there are 4.6 foreclosures per minute across the United States. And a foreclosure affects not only the individual who ends up losing his or her home, but it affects communities as well. You will drive through communities and they're blighted with empty, vandalized homes. The tax base suffers. The neighbor's house, when there's a vacant house next to it, the neighbor's house valuation decreases. So it's an epidemic that really needs to be addressed.
Let's go back to that couple who are behind in their mortgage. Given what the bankruptcy law is now, like when does it make sense for them to look at bankruptcy as an option?
Well, if they have fallen behind on their mortgage, we can propose a plan that will allow them to get current. So in essence, they would have to resume making their current monthly payment, whatever that is, and they also get an additional payment because the arrears then are paid over 36 to 60 months. So it you have to be financially able to assume that burden. We are not able to modify the primary mortgage loan. It just is not possible. Again, whether the lender is willing to do a voluntary loan modification, which again you hear about in the media all the time, we're not seeing that happen. But we remain optimistic that one of our clients will walk in and say, oh, by the way, I just obtained a mortgage loan modification, which would be the best case scenario. Mm-hmm. And we can't understand really why lenders will not do this more freely with these people, with these homeowners who are in trouble and possibly facing a foreclosure action. It seems like a win-win, really.
Yeah. It seems to me, if in a situation where you have a home that's a $400,000 home, was a $400,000 home, as in some states, now it's fallen to half that.
So sometimes it's better to just walk away from your home.
And many people are now coming in saying, I want to walk away from my home, which I've been doing this for 19 years. And there were many, many times over the past 18 years where I would counsel an individual that they really need to consider giving up their home, that they could not afford their home. And that is a very, very hard argument to make to somebody. They really don't want to hear it. People are very emotionally attached to their homes. However, now it is not uncommon for people to come in, and that's their plan. They want to walk away from their home. They realize it's underwater. They can't afford the mortgage payments. They're in an adjustable rate. They've been paying an interest only, perhaps, and they're realizing that that is the smart option for them.
We talked about the home because it's so important to people, but what about other things? It sounds like folks can keep a car if it's not worth very much.
You can keep a car. Again, you're allowed to have a car that has equity of $3,225. Again, if you're making a car payment on a car that's worth more than that, generally speaking, the loan amount is greater than the value of the car. Everybody knows you drive the car off the lot, it immediately depreciates. But you have to continue to make the payment if you want to keep that car.
Okay. I'm okay with my car and my mortgage, and I figured that all out and how that's going to work in bankruptcy. But I do have antiques that I got from my grandmother, or I have a stamp collection that I've been collecting since I was, 5 years old, and it's worth quite a bit of money. Can I keep those things if I go through bankruptcy?
It depends.
Okay.
You are allowed to exempt certain property. Collectibles can be exempted under what we refer to as the wild card exemption that exists under the federal bankruptcy law. However, the amount of the wild card exemption is tied to the amount of equity you exempt on your homestead. So it just depends what the collection might be worth and how much exemption you have left under the wild card exemption. If, however, you cannot fully exempt it, then again, a Chapter 13 would allow you to buy back that equity, assuming, again, you're an individual with some source of regular income, and you have the money to fund a plan to buy that equity back.
Okay, so I'm putting in the money that's the value of that item into the plan, in other words.
Correct.
Let's talk about Donald Trump. He's been in and out of bankruptcy a number of times over the years, but it still seems like he's flying all around the world and he's not really eating at McDonald's. How can that be? How can someone be in and out of bankruptcy and still be living what seems to most of us to be the high life?
Well, Donald Trump. I don't believe that Donald Trump has personally ever filed a bankruptcy. However, his companies are, and have, his current Trump casino or whatever it is down in New Jersey, that enterprise just recently filed a Chapter 11 bankruptcy. People incorporate businesses to protect themselves from the liability of the corporations, so that the corporation then, if they're in financial difficulty and the corporation wants to reorganize, the corporation can file a Chapter 11 bankruptcy, which again is similar, although a lot more complex, than the Chapter 13 reorganization.
So Chapter 11 is primarily for businesses?
It is primarily for businesses, yes, or individuals who do not qualify for the debt limitations for a Chapter 13. So that's how Donald Trump has managed to, live his high-flying lifestyle. He personally has never filed bankruptcy, and he probably has continued to take a very nice salary from his companies who have filed for bankruptcy.
Is Chapter 11 primarily then for businesses?
Yes.
So what does that do for them? What kind of benefits do they get from filing a Chapter 11?
Well, it allows them to restructure their debt. I mean, look at how many times we've seen airlines file bankruptcies and emerge from bankruptcies. They restructure their debt. A lot of times they will work with the secured lenders to restructure debt. Again, in the Chapter 11 arena, a bankruptcy judge can come in and judicially modify certain types of loans if it's an individual who has a vacation home or a yacht. There can be a judicial modification of that type of secured loan. And a lot of times your unsecured debt will, again, get pennies on the dollar. So that's an instance where, you know, a Chapter 11 would allow the bankruptcy to restructure its debt, again, circulating a Chapter 11 plan, which would operate as a new contract between the debtor and its creditors. It would fulfill its plan obligations, emerge from bankruptcy a stronger, healthier company.
We hope.
We hope.
So if a company is in Chapter 11, does that mean that they can get rid of their union, their obligations under a union contract for wages or for, you know, the kinds of things that they owe, or can that be changed?
Contracts can be modified in a Chapter 11. Again, a lot of times you're working with your creditors or with your union representatives to try to reach an outcome that's beneficial for everyone. Everybody has to give a little, perhaps, in order to survive, because if the business goes under, you, the union worker, will not have a job in that company. So again, a lot of times with the Chapter 11, there's a lot of negotiation and there's a lot of give and take.
That's what we're hearing with the automobile industry, that may be an option if the bailout doesn't work for them. And am I correct in saying that a large amount of that would be the ability to deal with some of the union contract issues?
I think so. But you see, right now, I believe the United Auto Workers Union has made major concessions so far just to try to work things out to keep these companies out of bankruptcy. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, I don't know what's going to happen with the car manufacturers. On a personal level, I almost feel like we should have rescued them instead of the big financial companies. I look at the devastation of losing any of them is so far reaching. You think about the upholstery makers and the people who are making the paints and the plastics and the tire companies. So I think if the auto companies go down, it'll be a great loss. However, at the same time, you look at them and you say, you know, you've had these troubles forever. Why have you done nothing voluntarily to try to address the public's concerns about the vehicles that you're making and to tighten your belt along the way? I mean, the perfect example is the three executives taking their own individual private jets down to Washington to go beg for money. They're just foolish.
So, like, when a company files bankruptcy, the income and the private assets of the people who work for the company, even if they're high level, those things are not looked at ever.
Well, I think that courts can now, I think they're scrutinizing salaries and bonuses, yes, people who are insiders, top management people. But generally, corporations are formed to insulate individuals from the liabilities of the corporation. So that's why people form corporations.
Suppose I'm working for a company and I miss a pay period, maybe I don't get my full pay, and they're having financial trouble. And I'm getting nervous. If they go into bankruptcy, am I going to be able to get my wages?
I believe there is a 90-day period, a look-back period. So if they filed bankruptcy on April 1st, you could look back 90 days, and that the wages that you were not paid as an employee, you could file an administrative claim. And on the level of priorities, administrative claims are pretty close to the top. So if there is a distribution, You're more or less at the top of the chain.
I didn't like that if. That if really bothers me. So if the company doesn't have any assets, I'm not getting paid.
You could be out of luck. And again, as an employee, if you're not getting paid, I think you need to go ask questions about the health of your company and perhaps even look around for a new job.
Yeah, I mean, if you're not getting paid, I would say look for a new job.
Yeah, I would too.
Definitely. Let's say I'm a student with a mountain of student loan debts. Students coming out these days can have $100,000 worth of debt or more. And I'm with this economy, I'm having a hard time getting a decent paying job, and I'm really struggling. Is bankruptcy going to help me with that?
No, bankruptcy is not going to help you with student loan debt. It is virtually Not at all. It is virtually impossible to discharge student loan debt. In order to get your student loan debt discharged, you have to prove a substantial hardship. And generally, what courts are looking for to prove a substantial hardship is perhaps a disability, a permanent disability. You know, if you're 22 years old or 25 years old or even 30 years old and you can't afford to pay your student loan, you still have many more years where you could potentially earn a lot of money. So they're not inclined to give you that relief unless there are circumstances where you have become, you know, permanently disabled and you're now on Social Security disability or some very minor amount of fixed income, and it's not going to be possible for you to repay that student loan debt.
So $100,000 could easily balloon into a whole lot more before someone begins to even chip away at it.
Easily.
Have you seen any of that in your?
Absolutely.
Wow.
I mean, it's out there, and I think, you know, a student going to college needs to consider that. It's great to be a full-time student, but at the same time, maybe you do have to take that part-time job in order to help put yourself through school.
Or consider community college.
which is a fabulous alternative.
Yeah.
And an affordable alternative.
What other kinds of debt can't you get rid of in bankruptcy?
Domestic support obligations, your alimony, your child support, you will never be able to get rid of those.
Do they get reduced at all? Or
they do not get reduced.
Okay.
So, you know, deadbeat parents, bankruptcy is not for you. You will have to pay your child support. You will have to pay your alimony. A lot of times the attorney's fees that the spouse has incurred trying to get you to pay your alimony or child support will not be dischargeable. IRS debt is another area that it has to meet certain criteria, but generally if it is something that has accumulated in the 3-year period before you have filed bankruptcy, you will not be able to discharge the IRS debt. Also, a big caveat is the debt that's incurred by fraud. If you have incurred a debt through some kind of fraudulent representation that a creditor has relied upon in making a loan to you, you will not be able to discharge that debt. In fact, the bankruptcy code has a provision. It's a presumption, and I believe it is for cash advances in excess of $500 incurred within 75 days of the date of filing, and credit card purchases for luxury goods and services in excess of, I want to say it's $900, $900 or $1,000 incurred within 90 days of the filing are not necessarily subject to discharge. There is a presumption that the debtor knew he or she was in financial trouble when those debts were incurred. And as a result, if the creditor objects to discharge, you may not be able to discharge those debts in a bankruptcy proceeding.
You talked about things that are non-dischargeable, and it reminded me of this kind of situation.
Okay, let's say Susie goes into bankruptcy, gets her debt taken care of, but Mom has co-signed the loan. Is Mom okay now? Is my debt going with hers?
No, Mom. You're still paying Susie's loan.
I don't get any kind of break.
You get no break whatsoever. In fact, you know, lenders love co-signer situations because if one, you know, two is better than one. Mm-hmm. If one ends up defaulting or filing a bankruptcy, then the other is on the hook. Mm-hmm. So Mama always pays.
The story of life. Okay.
Let's say that Tom goes into bankruptcy. He owes his grandmother $5,000, you know, elderly grandmom. They had a contract. He gets out of bankruptcy. That debt is discharged. Now, Tom, a few days later, wins the lottery. Can she get her money?
Yes, the United States Trustee's Office can revoke a discharge for up to a 1-year period. So if Tom comes into that kind of money and Grandma alerts the United States Trustee's Office, I feel pretty confident in saying that the United States Trustee's Office is going to take action to revoke the discharge and to claim as much of that lottery winnings as is necessary to pay Tom's debts.
So if it's 18 months later, Grandma's out of luck.
Grandma is out of luck.
Wow.
Let's say my house is about to be sold at a sheriff's sale. I run to the court and I file bankruptcy seconds before, and we can prove all this. What happens to the sheriff's sale?
Well, anything that happens prior to that bankruptcy filing, so before the sheriff's gavel falls, if you file a bankruptcy, that sheriff's sale is stayed. So, again, it's a race to the courthouse. Even if the sale should go through because the sheriff did not have notice, that sale is void. It's not wise to wait to the last second because, again, you do have to communicate to the other party that this has happened. But in the event where you have waited to the last minute and you beat the sheriff to the courthouse, that sheriff's sale will be stopped. The bankruptcy code has a provision that's referred to as the automatic stay provision. It's an extremely powerful provision. It stops all collection activity that could have been commenced or was commenced prior to the time of filing.
And how does it play out if I don't make it on time?
If I'm a day late?
Dollar short.
It seems like an area where the deadlines are really key.
They are key, but again, debtors know when the sheriff's sale is scheduled. They've been served with the foreclosure papers. They've been served with the judgment. The notice of the sheriff's sale has been posted on their door. They know when it's going to happen. They generally have about 3 months of notice from the time that sheriff's sale poster is plastered on their door that it's going to happen at this time on this day. So when you wait to the last minute, you snooze, you lose. And there's not a lot of sympathy for that kind of person who wants to stick his or her head in the sand.
Interesting. In general, what fascinates you about this area? You seem like you love bankruptcy.
I love practicing bankruptcy. I've done it for 19 years. I feel like I help people. I do represent debtors 99% of the time. I feel like I can make a difference in people's lives. I feel like I help them. I give them a fresh start. And recently, with the law change in 2005, there's a whole lot of areas in this new law that are not necessarily set in stone. So there's a lot of interesting legal arguments that a person is now able to make. So it's a lot of fun.
Great. Thank you, Ann.
Well, thank you for having me.